Protests and encampments take root here in New York with a movement to occupy Wall Street, drawing inspiration from the Arab Spring in Egypt and the protests in Spain. We turn to one of the people whose work has helped inspire those uprisings, Stephane Hessel. Stephane Hessel's new pamphlet-length book became a publishing sensation soon after it was released last October. Time for Outrage has sold more than 3.5 million copies worldwide. Stephane Hessel has occupied many positions in his life: immigrant, French resistance fighter, concentration camp survivor, diplomat, advocate, and author. Stephane Hessel was born in Berlin in 1917 and arrived in France at the age of 7. He joined the French resistance during the Second World War and was caught by the Gestapo and sent to the Buchenwald concentration camp. He escaped during transfer to Bergen-Belsen. He subsequently helped to draft the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights and became an honorary ambassador of France, appointed to special government missions. He has since been a fierce advocate of the rights of the Palestinian people. Welcome to Democracy Now!
Delighted to be with you this morning.
This book that has sparked such huge popularity all around the world for the ideas in it. It's a very short book, Time for Outrage. Tell us, why did you decide to write it, and have you been surprised by the response?
Very much surprised. When I first asked editor, Indigène edition of Montpellier, to publish a little pamphlet, a little appeal, I thought it would hark back to the French resistance, and that the movement of the French resistance brought up some basic values, which they consider fundamental, and they wanted General de Gaulle to apply when the war would be over.
This man lived through one of the most difficult periods in human history. He looked at fascism directly in its eyes, and he said, no, we will not tolerate you. And most important, he lived a victory over fascism. He lived a victory for freedom, for equality, for inclusiveness. So here is a man who is saying, I know what this battle was. I knew what it was unambiguously. I put my life on the line. And we won. And here we are 50 years later, or 60 years later, and we are not winning. There is, in his view, a new kind of totalitarianism. I think there's some truth to what he's saying about that. A new totalitarianism that restricts freedom, that does not expand freedom. Finance capitalism. He, and in the later book with Morin, they say it explicitly. Finance capitalism could be a source of new totalitarianism and fascism.
It's really in his late 80s and early 90s that he became known first to France and then to the rest of the world, first as a spokesperson for the sans-papiers in France, for those who were illegal immigrants and were being harassed by a series of different governments. But of course, outside of France, he was largely unknown. And then it really is only at the turn of the 21st century that Stephane Hessel, at the young age of 93, becomes not just a spokesperson for the sans-papiers in France, but the spokesperson for a movement of global reach and global concerns. He discovered a cause, or a cause discovered him. And he found just the right word, and it was a word that he, I believe, for the first time uttered in 2009 on the Plateau Glière in the Alps of France, and the word was indignation.
Donc, sachez que la désobéissance, que la préférence donnée aux valeurs par rapport à la loi, c'est une partie de notre citoyenneté de notre citoyenneté. Résistante, résister, c'est refuser d'accepter le déshonneur, c'est de continuer à s'indigner lorsque quelque chose est proposé qui n'est pas conforme à ses valeurs, qui n'est pas acceptable, qui est scandaleux. Et je le dis en particulier à ceux, et je sais qu'il y en a ici, venus de Grenoble ou d'ailleurs, qui commencent leur vie de jeunes et qui vont avoir un monde en face d'eux avec des défis qui ne peuvent être abordés utilement qu'en restant fermement attachés aux valeurs fondamentales sans lesquelles notre humanité risque de péricliter.
It really started as a political speech that he gave as a translator. I had to be very careful and really make sure that the language felt spoken to. And so there was no way I could use a term that would have sounded strange to an American ear, such as indignation, sadly. So there were a lot of many ways around it. But that's why Time for Outrage, that's how the choice was made. And it was really, because it had to be a call for arms too, and because we were losing it with the indignez-vous, the imperatif of indignez-vous, we had to really have something that said, okay, this is time, people, it's time. Time for outrage.
Comment s'y prendre? Attention, c'est ça qui est important. Comment vous, femmes, hommes, enfants, jeunes, qui êtes réunis dans ce site magnifique, comment vous y prendre? Eh bien, c'est en créant partout des réseaux de solidarité.
Indignados in Spain, the ignorati in Italy, les indignés in France, they have looked to Hessel at least to, as a means to identify their movement and to establish, in some sense, Hessel as their spiritual grandfather or godfather, if not the founder of the movement, somebody who has spoken on their behalf and has given them a sense of identity.
He came to us, Stéphane Hessel, after the revolution. He came like 6 months after the revolution and came to give us a lecture. And the place was packed because the people who knew him like me were there, and the people who never heard about Stéphane Hessel were there, and it was most of the most moving encounter we had in Tunisia after the revolution. He was speaking to young people and telling them, I can't even tell you, indignez-vous, you already did it. So tell me how it was to indignez-vous. Tell me this, how do you feel today? And he was taken like a hero.
For me as a European, and for everyone who's seen from up close what's been going on as a consequence to the publication of this book, really being involved in the process of getting it published in America was incredibly politically meaningful for me. And I felt very proud to be able to do that. But it was also, I think, I think I was aware from the very beginning of the enormous challenge that it would be to be publishing it here. Because ranging from the vocabulary to the values that this book conveys, we are here in this hyper-capitalistic society of America confronted to, you know, the absolute opposite of what the book says. So that was what I loved, really. It was the challenge of sort of bringing it forward and hoping that actually people would hear this voice here as they did in Europe.
We think these challenges, the one that you just described, human rights and extreme poverty, and of course the other great challenge of the Earth, the planet, which is being overexploited, we must bring people together with government experience and others with philosophical experience, and have them work together to change the way in which we look into the future. And that is why to be with you on Democracy Now! Is exactly what I'm dealing at. We need to get people to think that democracy is the answer. There is no answer to our worldwide problems, but to work all together in a spirit of basic values that are the values of democracies.
We have to keep in mind that Hessel's understanding of resistance was aimed not just at the Nazis. It was aimed at what existed prior to the Nazis, at this control that financial and that banking institutions had. And for him, a true liberation was not just the kicking out of the Nazis. A true liberation for France was the installation, was the creation of a society in which not just one's formal rights were recognized, but one's economic rights were recognized and one's social rights were recognized. And it's these very issues that the Wall Street movement has been calling fault for.
Families for Freedom. It's a New York-based multi-ethnic group fighting against detention and deportation. And the reason why we're involved with Occupy Wall Street is the money that is usually found behind these immigration policies, and then which leads to large detention centers, which means profits to people who invest in these private prison companies.
So when we hear down in Wall Street and we say, stop the private detention, end Wall Street influence in all these laws, immigration laws that make us supposedly less than human beings, that's why we are out here.
People know you're not legal, they work you to death. Some of the speakers spoke about wage theft. That is current and constant, and these are things that you're undocumented, you face these things. This is of the stuff that we have to occupy Wall Street, let the 1% know that we know where they're coming from, but also the 99% around the world realize that the fight is not necessarily only against Wall Street. It's a system that says one person is better than another, sometimes because of where you're born, but more so because of color of skin.
Only when movements like Occupy Wall Street, or indeed the Arab Spring, started to arise, did we begin to get serious movement, that people truly pay attention to inequality in America and the unfairness of the distribution of economic benefits. And I think the same around the world. The Arab Spring represented a throwing off of dictatorship, but we shouldn't be naive about that. It also meant a throwing over of a certain kind of economic system that was really beholden to the West. The West supported many of these dictatorships. Back here in the West, Occupy Wall Street and all its brethren in London, throughout the United States, not only in New York, they were talking about throwing off the shackles of a different kind of dictatorship, a dictatorship of what turned out to be finance. It was not an exaggeration.
It is proper for the young generation to listen to the very old ones who tell them, we have been resistors at a time where there was fascism or Stalinism. You must find the things that you will not accept, that will outrage you, and these things you must be able to fight against non-violently, peacefully, but determinedly. That is why I'm so happy about what happens these days in Wall Street, because they're indeed very peaceful. They're not throwing any bombs or any stones, but they're there determined to see that their values are to be respected.
When you start a revolution, that's we find about it, any one of us find that he was having something he were living with, but he can't stand anymore. It's very moving, because any one of us, bourgeois, people from the street, people, normal people, intellectual, each one of us went into some kind of analysis. Each one of us were having reasons to say no and never said it. And that is something horrible to live, because you ask yourself, but how come did I accept such horrible thing? Because it was really hard to live in Tunisia. And we become one. Each one of us with this suffering, either because they are not working or either other than an intellectual who accept the no to his words for so many years. We just went together in extreme solidarity.
The best known and perhaps most controversial phrases in Albert Camus' The Rebel is this pseudo-Cartesian phrase in which he claims, I rebel, therefore we are. Now, of course, it doesn't have the same rigor, logical rigor, of Descartes' original cogito ergo sum, but it has a moral rigor. It has an experiential vigor, something that Camus learned in his experience during the Second World War. It's at that very moment when you confront a force that denies your fundamental humanity, and you tell that force, no, I refuse to accept this indignity, this slight, this attack on my human person. At that very moment, when you rebel against that force, you recognize that you're not alone. That is the baseline for humankind. When you say no, suddenly you hear to your left and to your right others saying no as well. And there is this recognition of solidarity at this very moment of rebellion. I don't know if Stéphane Hessel ever spoke to this, but whether he did or not is really besides the question. It's clear that his entire life is a testament to acting upon this.
When French are speaking about the spirit of resistance, of course it is resisting the oppression, resisting the evil. It's a spirit of solidarity. How can you resist? How can you resist? The individual is not able to resist alone. To be a resistant is not to fight for yourself, but to fight for the community. When you say fraternité, fraternity, it's like it means solidarity. It's the same idea. And the whole spirit of resistance was to say, not only liberty, but also equality, and mainly solidarity, fraternity among the people. You know, to be together, to fight together, to help each other.
Perhaps one of the most moving documents that an American can watch, and that anybody can watch for that matter, is something that occurred 5 years prior to his speech, the talk that he gave at the Plateau of Glière, and it was the recording of Stéphane Hessel along with about a dozen other members of the resistance. They made a video in which they spoke to the youth of France, and they asked them to act on behalf of solidarity with those who did not have, for those who didn't have the proper papers, for those who didn't have the opportunities that they, for example, have had in France, to act on their behalf in the name of solidarity.
À ceux et à celles qui feront le siècle qui commence, nous voulons dire avec notre affection, créer, c'est résister. Résister, c'est créer.
There's nothing wrong with it. Just, you know, wear and tear.
We'll take it.
You got big plans for the old gal?
Good morning, and deadly news, a bizarre shooting spree in Maryland.
The sniper ravaging the Washington, D.C. area.
Among crime stories, there are whodunnits, but there are also whydunnits. The latter describes the new film Blue Caprice, which is based on the deadly sniper attacks in the Washington area in the fall of 2002. But how much can we really know about why two men, one older and the leader, the other younger and vulnerable, would commit such calculated acts of violence? Canapé talks with Paris-born, New York-based writer and director Alexandre about his creative investigation of a crime spree in early 21st century America.
Kids are natural.
Le film, pour moi, je l'ai construit de manière analogique. Et les personnages j'ai tout fait pour épurer que les personnages deviennent des figures archétypales. Des archétypes, mais...
Le personnage du père, dans ta tête, ça pouvait être le personnage de l'État.
Oui, bien sûr.
Des États-Unis.
C'est absolument ça, oui. C'est une métaphore, oui. Sur la question, c'est que quand j'en ai parlé à Isaiah, la question c'était qui sont nos pères, quelle éducation recevons-nous de nos pères. Et je dirais même plus, c'était même la façon dont j'ai expliqué le script à Isaiah, c'était le Blue Caprice, c'est l'histoire de it will be the story of the failure of a father. And really a father as a really like we're all children and where, you know, what is this world that we are received from them.
And so Greg, you're gonna be at a 45 degree, so you know you're like kind of a step behind him, you know?
Et donc cette histoire de corruption, comme ça, de cet enfant que Blue Caprice chronique. Et je pense, oui, donc c'est pour ça que cette figure d'enfant est très importante, parce que tu parles des médias, je ne pense même pas que ce soit, même au niveau des médias, ça me semble même encore plus fort que les médias. C'est vraiment les structures de la société, en tout cas aux États-Unis, et les relations sociales sont vraiment fondées sur un rapport de force, sur un rapport de violence. Ces rapports sont validés par les médias, mais ils existent, je pense, voilà, dès le tout jeune âge, par rapport à la façon dont les gens sont dans la rue, les écoles, les policiers. Le monde est bizarrement fondé comme ça sur une intolérable loi du plus fort et loi du plus riche, quoi, malheureusement. Ouais.
This used to be my neighborhood, you know. I used to live here. People used to live here. The real people, I thought. Everybody turned into ghosts. Like I didn't exist anymore. Well, not everybody. Some of them turned out to be vampires. Sucked me dry. People I would have never expected. My wife. Just one day I woke up and you know how I didn't see it before. It's evil. Real evil. There are some evil people in this world. Like here, the lady who lives here is a real piece of testified against me in court. That's what they do. They take your kids away, say that I kidnapped them. How can I kidnap my own kids? They're my kids. Then she just gets to live here, like nothing ever happened. A f***ing vampire. I hope she dies.
Vampires can't die. She's already dead.
That's right. Because they aren't people. What kind of person breaks up a family like that anyway?
I think the film is extremely political in many ways. But when it comes down to the problem of violence and the appetite that this country has for violence, it's a very complicated question. The death instinct in America is much greater than the life instinct, you know. Lee is 17-year-old receiving military training. It's obviously an analogy also for the hundreds of thousands of young Americans who went through, you know, military training in the last 10 years, and since 9/11, we're talking about like an entire generation of 17-year-old American that went abroad and learned to use violence.
Want to try it? Kids are natural.
I brought you here. I gave you all this. I need you to do something for me. The lady who lives here testified against me in court.
pour moi, c'est un film éminemment politique, mais la lecture politique du film n'est pas apparente. C'est pas un film didactique. C'est juste quelque chose qui reflète l'air du temps. Et comme tu l'as remarqué, toutes les commentaires politiques qu'il peut avoir ne fonctionnent vraiment par rapport par analogie ou par métaphore. Donc c'est pas de ce point de vue-là un film complètement engagé politiquement. C'est pas un outil politique. Moi, j'ai toujours dit que ce film, c'était avant tout un film très personnel, en fait. C'est une plainte personnelle par rapport à ce que je ressens moi en tant qu'humain et en tant qu'artiste. Donc je suis trop pessimiste pour penser qu'on puisse changer quoi que ce soit. Donc tout ce qu'on peut faire, c'est pleurer.
The sniper must be able to calmly and deliberately kill without an apparent reason. The sniper must not be susceptible to emotions such as anxiety or remorse.
Go. Go.